preparing it. So yeah, that's a trick to do it next time.
Is it on now?
It's on. I'm going to hand it back to you.
Yes. Go ahead and make me host again. Okay, awesome. All right, I'll give everybody a minute or two to hop on. Hello, everyone. Okay, perfect. All right, looks like we have a good amount of people on the list. Here, I will go ahead and get us started. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Carla Leon, and I am a program coordinator here at the California Foundation for Independent Living Centers. I have been with CFILC for about 7 months now, and I will be moderating today's webinar. For visual purposes, I am a Latina woman with medium length orange hair, wearing a blue shirt with polka dots, and my Zoom background is an orange background with our Disability Disaster Access and Resources logo. For accessibility purposes, I will be going over a couple of options here that you can use. First off, if you would like to access captions, go to the meeting controls on the bottom of your screen and select the CC icon titled Live Transcript. You may also click on the option Show Subtitles to view them there. I will also be dropping a stream text link into the chat, which you can use. This is a great option because you can change the font, color, or make the captioning full screen. There will also be ASL interpreters live on camera. For visual purposes, please note you can use the slider bar to minimize the slides to view both our upcoming presentation and the Zoom videos. Similarly, if you are blessed with two screens, you may adjust to view the presentation on one side and the chat and Zoom on another. Please note we will have our chat open for discussion and comments. Here at CFILC, we have a zero tolerance policy on harassment, so let's keep things respectful. I will also be muting all participants until the end of our presentation. At the end of our presentation, we will have a Q&A portion, but you are also welcome to send in the Q&A box any questions at any time. We will not be moderating the chat for any questions. At the Q&A section, we ask that you raise your hand if you are asking a question, if that is verbally more accessible to you. We will try our best to address everyone's questions in the time that we have allotted. Thank you all for sitting through my bit of housekeeping. I will go ahead and pass it along to Bob to get us started.
Hello, my name's Bob Hand. Go by he, him for pronouns. I'm the interim executive director of CFILC. I'm an older white male with glasses, and my background is the doors of my office. So I want to tell you about what CFILC is. And can we go to the next screen? Okay. So CFILC, California Foundation for Independent Living Centers, is a nonprofit corporation. It has two primary functions. One is that it's the membership organization for 25 independent living centers in California. That means that we assist them in representation at both the state and federal legislatures and also state and federal agencies. We also provide training for independent living centers and other kinds of coordinating services. Now, CFILC is also a hub for statewide grants. So we sometimes get grants that are to be used throughout the state of California, and then we coordinate with the other independent living centers, spreading that money out in grants to them, coordinating services, and basically supporting the kinds of services that are provided by those particular grants, which you're going to hear more about as we proceed. So that's the basis of what CFILC is. Let me introduce you to our management team with the next slide, I believe.
We're actually going to go ahead and hand it over to TJ Hill to speak a little bit about the independent living philosophy first.
Great. Okay. And so, TJ, do you want to step up and present this?
Hi, my name is TJ Hill. I am the executive director of an independent living center, the Disability Community Resource Center in Los Angeles, serving Western Los Angeles County. I'm also the board chair of CFILC. So I'm going to go over today just what the basic IL philosophy is and sort of give everyone an introduction into independent living. So independent living philosophy was influenced by the self-help and consumer and civil rights movements of the 1960s and 70s in America. Independent living does not mean that we want to do everything by ourselves and we don't need anybody, or that we don't, or that we want to live in isolation. It's actually quite the opposite. We rely more on interdependence and creating community. We demand the same choices and control in our everyday lives that our non-disabled brothers and sisters, neighbors and friends take for granted. If we regard our disabilities as tragedies, we will be pitied. If we feel ashamed of who we are, our lives will be regarded as useless. As long as we remain silent, we will be told by others what to do. That's by Adolf Ritzka, who's a disability justice advocate, and he wrote that in 2005. Next slide, please. The IL philosophy is based on four principles. The first is deinstitutionalization. Then we have demedicalization, barrier removal, and consumer control. Deinstitutionalization means that people with disabilities belong in the community, not in an institution. We think today that's pretty fundamental, but at the time, that was a really radical concept. Demedicalization is that people with disabilities are not patients to be cured, children to be taken care of, nor brave souls to be admired. Barrier removal means that people with disabilities are subjected to social injustices, societal barriers, and discrimination. There is nothing to fix regarding the person's disability. It's those barriers that we want to remove. Consumer control is people with disabilities are in a better position to manage their resources and be in charge of the assistance they may require. And consumer control is really a foundation for the entire independent living movement. Next slide, please. So the independent living services at the independent living centers are broken into different core services. So we have five federal core services. Originally, we had four, but we added a fifth much later. So the five federal core services are peer support and counseling, information and referral, independent living skills instruction, self-advocacy and systems advocacy, and then finally transition services, which are nursing facility diversion and transitions to the community and youth transitions. And those were added in 2014 under the Workforce Innovation and Opportunities Act. Those core services are consistent across the entire United States. But in California, we have additional state core services that were added under our state independent living plan. So those state core services are personal assistance services, housing assistance, assistive technology, information and referral, and education. Next slide. And that's all I have for you. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, I think this
can part- I'm sorry to interrupt, Bob, but right now we are having some issues where our stream text is not working and we have many people who are attending who are unable to participate. Can we take a moment while the captioner is able to get us set up with our stream text link?
Sure. Yeah.
Thank you, Kat. I'm working with her now to see what the issue is. Hold on one moment. I'm just going to be doing some quick testing. Hold on one moment, everyone. Thank you so much for your patience. Can someone try to get it on and let me know if it works?
So far, it's still not working.
Hello, this is the captioner. I do have everything working on my end. And if you guys just start talking, I'm sure it should override anything that's happening in Zoom.
Captioning is showing on my end.
Okay, then should I proceed?
Well, captioning is showing in Zoom, but it's not showing up in the stream text link.
Okay,
then I'm going to wait.
I'm going to go and put I'm going to copy the stream text link and I'm going to put it in chat to Carla. I did that earlier, so I'm not sure if something changed, but this is the updated, this is the current stream text link that I just put in chat.
Okay, thank you. Let me put that into the chat. Okay, it's on there. Let's see if it's working now. Thank you everybody for your patience again.
Okay, so I should proceed. Is that correct? Okay, I guess
one second, Bob.
Okay,
it looks like some people are saying it's working. Kat, can you double check for me?
It's still not working for me, but if you have participants saying it's working, maybe it's on my end.
Okay. Hold on one second.
And we are so sorry for the delay, everyone, but if we wouldn't want to continue without it being accessible to all of our attendees.
Victor, I'm going to see if I can make you host, if you wouldn't mind you trying the settings. Everything looks fine on my end, but let's get a second set of eyes on it.
I am being told by one of our participants that the StreamText link is working for them.
Yep, captioning settings look good, Carla, and the StreamText link is working as well.
Okay, perfect. Can you make me host again? Awesome. Thank you, everybody. Congratulations on going through our first set of problems. All right, Bob, I'll go ahead and send it over to you.
Okay, this is Bob Hand again. I want to introduce our admin team. Two of our members aren't available for the webinar today, so I'll introduce them. The first is our Deputy Director, Megan Cowdell. There's a picture of her up on the screen with light hair, a dark outfit on. She's smiling and she's standing in front of a wooden roost with her green parrot on it because she does parrot rescue. Then there's our operations manager, Shayna Brody. There's also a picture of Shayna on the screen. She has long blonde black hair or blonde hair and a black outfit on, a white lady who's in front of a brown background and smiling. Beyond that, we have our finance department. And so, Phil, if you'll introduce yourself and then your staff can introduce themselves.
Yes, I'm Philip Thompson, Finance Director. Pronouns are he, him. I've been at CFILC for 17 years. I'm a white male wearing glasses, kind of brown and gray hair with a mustache. My background is a CFILC yellow background with all the program logos. I oversee the finance department and accounting and contracts. I'd like to go ahead and introduce Justin. Justin, you're muted.
Sorry. Hello, my name is Justin Caton. My pronouns are he, him. For audio purposes, I am a Caucasian male with a shaved head and a graying goatee. I'm wearing a black polo shirt with the CFILC yellow background with all of the program logos affiliated on it. I am the bookkeeper here at CFILC. I've been here for approximately 3.5 months, and I will be passing it over to Evelyn.
Hello, everyone. My name is Evelyn Cavazos, pronouns as she, her. For audio purposes, I am a Latin woman with brown hair, wearing prescription glasses, a black blouse with the CFILC yellow background. I am the accounting clerk, and I'm passing it back. I've been here for about a month and a half, passing it back to Dan.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dan Okenfuss. I am the public policy manager for CFILC. I'm a Caucasian male with thinning blonde hair and wearing a blue shirt and a navy blazer. I have the CFILC background behind me, along with our program logos. Today, I'm going to talk to you about our CFILC public policy priorities. And in the description is the CFILC logo, increasing access and equal opportunity for people with disabilities by building the capacity of independent living centers. Next. At CFILC, we are here to tell you about advocacy. It's core to the mission of independent living centers. We are united, the CFILC staff and public policy committee, made up of a number of our executive directors, of our members, review legislation, work towards delivering a unified message to our representatives in the California legislature and to the U.S. Congress. We have partners in this advocacy. We join forces with many allies in aging and disability communities in advocating for our priorities. Next slide. What are we advocating? We have a number of issues that we monitor in the state and federal arenas. We are very focused right now on increasing funding for ADRCs and the No Wrong Door programs hosted by our California Department of Aging. We're always in favor of expanding healthcare access to needy consumers. We're also pushed for long-term services and supports benefits. Always on the forefront of our mind is the fact that we live in California, a very expensive community here, and we are always fighting for affordable and accessible housing for our consumers. Also on the labor front, we push for fair wages for workers with disabilities, and at the same time, we're also pushing for fair wages for our caregivers, allow us to live comfortably in our own homes. Lately, we've been picking up a few more issues that help out our communities. One is a new technology called mobile fueling on demand, and we've backed legislation that will help provide fuel service for our vehicles at our own homes and offices, rather than us going to filling stations. We've also been pushing for programs to fight the high costs of durable medical equipment, or DME, and we have sponsored legislation that will work towards reuse and recycling programs for this equipment. And finally, we've pushed for funds to help our small business owners make their own workplaces and businesses more accessible for people with disabilities. Next slide. We've had a lot of success over the past year in our public policy priorities at the state capitol. We have supported five bills last year that were signed into law by the governor, and they dealt with conservatorship reform, a very controversial practice. We're trying to find alternatives to allow people to still have their rights and their dignity when they're in a conservatorship arrangement by the courts. We're also, as I mentioned, looking for improved access for disabilities, people with disabilities to enter small businesses, and also looking for affordable housing incentives for people who are on the verge of experiencing homelessness who are also receiving Medi-Cal benefits. And we also have legislation that will help make the transition smoother for eligible individuals out of skilled nursing facilities and back into independent living. And then finally, we have our youth organization, which you'll hear about later, who were very successful in pushing a bill that promoted CalFresh benefits for college students. Next slide, please. On the budget front, CFILC has been very active in supporting for additional funding for various programs that are important to our consumers. Last year, we supported a successful budget ask of $5 million towards research on expanding long-term services and supports benefits, or LTSS, increased funding for affordable housing, California Community Transitions, IHSS, which is the in-home services and supports, and then Medi-Cal, and also SSI-SSP. But there's a dark cloud on our horizon for the budget this year. We are hearing of lower than forecasted state revenues. So that may mean that we had to shift from promoting new programs to protecting existing programs in the budget. So our allies and CFILC, we're going to work together to fight any unfair spending cuts to vital programs that provide healthcare and social services for our consumers. Next slide. How do we advance public policy outcomes for our consumers? We have a grassroots network of thousands of consumers that are served by our 25 independent living centers across the state. We provide training and tools for our independent living center leaders and consumers to learn how to better engage with our elected officials and all levels of government. And then we even provide expert analysis that is live streamed to our members. And so they're all better prepared to testify and express their positions. That is my presentation, and I left my email address if you want to reach me. It's dan@cfilc.org. And now we'll pass it on to my colleague, Goldie House, who will tell you about the DO Network.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Dan. Hello, my name is Talmadge House. I am a statewide community organizer for the Disability Organizing Network, known as DO Network, abbreviated capital D, capital O, and network in lowercase here at the CFILC. My image description is light blue background with a logo circle over my top right shoulder, reads DO Network and Disability Organizing. The DO is in light blue and above the network in green. I am a middle-aged Black male with light skin complexion. I am wearing a royal blue polo shirt. I have black cornrows going towards the back of my head. I am wearing large rim black glasses and have a shaved goatee. Next. Thank you and welcome. Who are we? The DO Network is a comprehensive network. Systems change advocates and community organizers throughout California's 28 ILCs, known as independent living centers, formed in 1997, has been organizing and growing, reminding the world nothing about us without us. Also working to grow the disability community to be recognized amongst decision makers in California. Also provide guidance and assistance with community organizing and systems change support issues impacting our communities. Our network has had many organizing and advocacy successes, some of which include increasing the accessibility of polling places, increasing COVID-19 access prioritization for individuals unable to obtain the vaccine, amongst others. Next. Sorry. You can find the DO Network by contacting independent living or resource centers to find your systems change advocate and community organizers in your area. We also do value the opportunity for you to come share your experiences with us through work groups, storytelling, and social media posts. Next slide. Our goals of the DO Network are resources, providing resources embodying the implementation of the Olmstead Act to preserve the rights of people with disabilities to live in the community settings instead of in institutions. We also educate and inform, focusing on five areas of empowering individuals and groups to build their collective power and voices. These areas are community organizing, voter education, the Olmstead Act, housing and transportation, and schools, while staying open and engaged to all possibilities of positive change. Social media presence, we will be working to increase and utilizing TikTok and Facebook, reaching out and connecting with so many individuals, making new friends online, sharing posts while participating in activities or an event. Empowering advocates and organizers to organize the community and organize the community. Gotta slow down, my apologies. Organize the community, educate on issues important for people with disabilities, with skills and strategies to build these powerful conversations in communities of concern. Annual Advocacy Day. CFILC and the DO Network will in the future be hosting an annual Advocacy Day at the Capitol, where advocates and organizers can join together and meet with representing legislation. More information will be announced in the future regarding this Advocacy Day. Organizing collective voices. We organize the collective voices, and which are used to exercise the community power when wanting to make a change, make decisions they believe will work, individuals will believe will work to win a meaningful change in their lives and change the system. DO Network will also provide grassroots for our advocacy. This is done to amplify community messages across all levels of the government. It is an effective, powerful way to communicate with elected representatives which is considered indirect lobbying. Coming up next is an amazing team, program, and key player in inclusion and many communities for individuals with disabilities seen and unseen. Please welcome Ability Tools. Thank you.
Thank you, Goldie. This slide prominently displays the Ability Tools logo across the top half. A theme that you'll likely see a lot of today is how much our programs support one another. If it weren't for the work of systems change advocates, like the ones working in DO Network, we wouldn't have a program like our program, Ability Tools, which works hard to, among other things, support systems change programs. We do that by connecting people to resources that make life and therefore organizing more accessible. Hi, my name is Catherine Crowley. I use she, her pronouns, and I am CFILC's Ability Tools Program Manager. And I've been with CFILC for a bit over 3 years now. For audio description purposes, I am a Chicanx woman with dark brown and sunset colored hair, with light tan skin and a purple virtual background displaying the Ability Tools and CFILC logos. I am joined by my colleagues, Victor Mendoza, the Ability Tools Program Coordinator 2, and Ine Mendoza, the Ability Tools Program Specialist, who you'll get to meet in just a few moments as we teach you about our program and what our team and network does. Next slide, please. So if you're new to Ability Tools and you want to learn more, you might ask, what exactly is Ability Tools? Ability Tools is California's Assistive Technology Act program that provides a variety of services for Californians with disabilities to help increase awareness of, access to, and acquisition of assistive technology, or AT. Which might find you asking, what is assistive technology and what are some examples of this kind of technology? Assistive technology, or AT, is any item, device, or piece of equipment used to maintain or improve the lives of people with disabilities, providing more independence in education, employment, recreation, and daily living activities. AT includes the services necessary to get and use the devices, including assessment, customization, repair, and training. Assistive technology can be broken into three basic tiers: low, mid, and high. Low-tech IT are items like a pencil grip holder, communication cards, or a handheld magnifying glass. Mid-tech IT are items like an alarm clock that shakes your bed, a pillbox reminder, or a no-grip electric can opener. And some high-tech AT items are items like Dragon Naturally Speaking software, smart home hubs and their support peripherals, or an adaptive gaming setup, which can include a device that serves as a hub for any combination of switches, sip and puffs, or joysticks. More information can be found on the website for AT3 that will be linked in the slides that you received with the webinar. There are technical assistance and supports provided to all of the state assistive technology programs. And with that, I'll pass it on to Victor.
Thank you, Catherine. Hello, good morning, everyone. My name is Victor Mendoza, and I am the program coordinator too here at CFILC. I've been at CFILC for a year and a half. My pronouns are he, him, and for audio description purposes, I am a Latino man in my 20s with brown skin and black hair. Today, I'm wearing a blue collared shirt. I have my glasses on and I am in front of a purple background with the Ability Tools logo on the upper left corner. Today, I'll be talking about what AT Act activities are required. Let's start with state leadership activities. State leadership activities deal with information providing elements of AT Act requirements. Public awareness is executed through developing information regarding the availability, cost, and benefits of assistive technology, which is then distributed through mass communication and outreach events. Information and assistance is more consumer-driven, consisting of one-on-one support, service implementation, and referrals. Training activities are instructional events. These events are designed to increase knowledge, skills, and capability regarding AT. Technical assistance consists of providing support to organizations that will result in improved outcomes for these organizations' consumers by increasing efficiency, effectiveness, and sometimes funding. Now let's move on to state-level activities. State-level activities are much more hands-on, working to get AT directly into the hands of a consumer. Device demonstrations compare the features and benefits of different AT, enabling an individual to make an informed choice. Device loans aim to assist in decision-making to serve as a loaner while the consumer is waiting for device repair or funding, or to provide an accommodation on a short-term basis. Device reuse activities support the exchange, repair, recycling, or other reutilization of AT. Reuse is a solution for individuals who need items public sources will not pay for, who need a device that is no longer manufactured, or who need a device while they obtain funding for their permanent device. Reuse also includes exchange programs where individuals can sell or donate a device to others in need. Open-ended loans are also supported where the consumer can continue to use the device until it is no longer needed. State financing activities increase access to and funding for AT and assistive services. And I will now hand it over to Inay Mendoza.
Thank you, Victor. My name is Inay Mendoza. My pronouns are she, her, and I am the INA specialist. I have been with CFILC for around 4 months. I am a Latina Korean woman in her 20s. I have short black hair and am wearing a dark blue blouse. I have a background with the ability tools and CFILC logos. I will now give some examples of a few ability tool services that are available for Californians. Public awareness is achieved by ability tool staff participating in outreach events and creating blogs, newsletters, video newsletters, and more. The information and assistance line helps answer assistive technology questions and refers individuals to different centers, partner reuse, loan, home modification centers, and more. There are trainings available for the public and AT professionals on topics such as DLDCs, partner organizations, services, and devices, and on new technologies and services. Technical assistance changes year to year. For this past year's activity, CFILC presented ability tools research to Department of Health Services, which resulted in assistive technology successfully being added to home and community-based waivers. Device Lending and Demonstration Centers, or DLDCs, provide demonstration of devices and provide free short-term device loans. To see what devices are available, you can visit the NATADS Public Access website. The Keep the Wheels Rolling Fund provides applying nonprofit organizations funding to purchase parts and supplies needed to repair or refurbish a wheelchair or scooter that was donated to their program. The wheelchair is then provided at no cost to a person with a disability. A form of state financing is through the Freedom Tech Financial Loan Program, which provides individuals with affordable financial loans ranging from $500 to $15,000 to purchase needed assistive technology. Thank you. If you're interested in learning more about ability tools, please reach out to us. Our contact information has just been added to the chat. Now I will pass it over to Jessica from Yo Disabled and Proud.
Sorry. Everyone, hello. My name is Jessica Riestra. I am the statewide youth organizer with CFILC, and I help oversee the Yo program. Just my quick pronouns. My pronouns are she, her, ella. Beyond that, a quick image description of myself is that I am a brown Latina woman with brown eyes, dark brunette hair, and I am wearing like a sweater, and I have the Yo background, which is behind me, and yeah, and I am in my 20s, and I've been with CFILC for a little bit over a year, and yeah, let's get started. All right, so every single year, it is really important to start off the year really great. And every year at the beginning of the year, we celebrate Ed Roberts Day, which is on January 23rd. And we recently actually did a pretty awesome celebration where we had amazing speakers. And they really delved deep into talking about what the future looks like and what Ed's legacy entailed. And last year, we also did awesome because we were able to talk with people who knew Ed Roberts and be able to delve deep into their individual connection with him, as well as just like what they envisioned the future to look like as well. So if y'all want to know more, honestly, I would recommend going into our YouTube page because they were awesome presentations. All right, next. And I am so sorry for the noise background. All right, a quick other thing that we do is we do the Disabled Voices of Color speaker series. We started that last year, and now we're doing it on a bi-monthly level. As you can see, one of our awesome speakers, which we started with, was Mia Mingus, who was hella awesome and hella cool to interview. And in this, what the Disabled Voices of Color speaker series entails is that we invite BIPOC disability activists to speak about their advocacy within the community and how youth can be involved. Next. All right, so as Dan had mentioned something that we also take a stance on are some bills that specifically affect youth. In this case, in 2022, we took a stance on the CalFresh bill because CalFresh is something that specifically affects youth, especially if you are a first-generation college student and you need that sense of necessity. The whole aspect of this CalFresh bill that passed was to make it more accessible and easier to be able to apply for CalFresh. Next. Awesome. So a little bit more to talk about some of the collaborations and events that we do. We'll start with discussing our partnership with Bender Academy. That partnership entails in being able to emphasize on the importance of mental health and being able to do videos to talk about your individual experiences and how mental health affects you. Another awesome partnership that we have is that we're partnering with different immigration disability groups to be able to talk about the importance that no matter your background and so on, that it's so important to make sure that your voices are being heard. A third partnership that we have is with, we work a lot with different CFILC members on different projects where they want to have youth voices being presented, and we're very honored and privileged that our Yale volunteers or myself are able to sit in those individual meetings. We also are doing a partnership with DREDF on two different projects. One project specifically emphasizes on making sure that we have stock photos that are edited and that we're able to have a sense of representation when it comes towards their individual disability, as well as being able to have a sense of inclusivity when it comes towards representation. And lastly, our partnership is with Ability Tools. As they have discussed, we try to make sure that we incorporate youth within the individual work that we do. And some quick events that we are running, which is starting next month, is the Statewide Monthly Youth Call. This is pretty much where we're able to have monthly calls where youth voices are being heard and they're able to sit at the table and talk about issues that specifically affect them. We had started this last year, but we were a lot of individual things we were working on, so we kind of discontinued it, but I saw that that was something that was very beneficial, where we had different folks of different ILCs being able to come together and sit and discuss it. So I'm very excited to bring that back, as well, not only speaking towards youth reps from each individual ILC, but also making sure that their youth consumers are able to partake in it, because it's really awesome when we have a lot of youth voices coming together for a common cause. In addition to that, we have Yo Camp, our Yo Youth Connect groups, Disability History Week, which is part of YLF. Next. All right, so quick few things is statewide meetings and Yo meetings. So if you want to join YAC, which is our Youth Advisory Council, we are relaunching it this year. The goal of YAC is to set goals and objectives for Yo. It is a two-year commitment, which meets on a quarterly basis, which the first meeting is going to be in person. And in order to be able to partake in that, you have to be between the ages of 16 to 28. And if you want to become a Yo volunteer, it is a commitment of 16 hours a month of doing community service, a whole year program. There is a link if you want to join. We would really love to be able to have as many folks as possible because we're very much about making the intersectionalities of putting a lot of social issues for a common cause with disability being the forefront. And those are weekly meetings. And in order to be a Yale volunteer, you have to be the ages of 16 to 28. So with that, that is Yo, and I really would love to be able to see many people join in on our meetings because they're hella awesome. And thank you. That's all. And now to pass it to our digital access folks, which is Victor and Nene.
Thank you, Jessica. Hello again. My name is Victor Mendoza, and I am the program coordinator too at CFILC. I am in front of a red background with the Digital Access Project logo on the upper left corner. On this slide, we have an image of the Digital Access Project logo. Next slide, please. So what is the Digital Access Project? The Digital Access Project, or DAP, is a program at CFILC aimed to help close the digital divide across California. It is funded by the California Emerging Technology Fund, CETF. CFILC has been providing low-cost internet options to low-income and people with disabilities since 2014 through the Digital Access Project. The COVID-19 pandemic has increased public recognition of the digital divide, and here at CFILC, we believe that it is crucial that internet becomes a utility rather than a luxury. Next slide, please. Through the Digital Access Project, staff are able to help consumers in California apply for low-cost internet service ranging from $10 to $20 a month. The providers we currently work with are Spectrum, Frontier, AT&T, Comcast, and Cox. In addition, CFILC has been assisting consumers apply for the Affordable Connectivity Program, also known as ACP, which is a $30 discount from your internet service. Next slide, please. There are several ways you can qualify for low-cost internet. Depending on the internet service provider available in your area, you may be eligible for low-cost internet if you or someone in your household receives Medi-Cal, CalFresh, Section 8 housing, or supplemental security income. You can also qualify if you have a child in K-12 that participates in the National School Lunch Program, NSLP, or if you are a college student that was awarded a federal Pell Grant for the current school year. In addition to the qualifying documents already mentioned, you can qualify for the Affordable Connectivity Program if you are enrolled in WIC, receive a veteran's pension, or through your household's income. I will now hand it over to Inay, who will talk about the Affordable Connectivity Program in the next slide.
Thank you, Victor. Hi, this is Inay again. I have a background with the Digital Access Project and CFILC logos. I will now elaborate on the Affordable Connectivity Program, otherwise known as the ACP. It is a Federal Communications Commission's program aimed to close the digital divide by helping ensure low-income households have internet service for essential things such as work, school, and more. The ACP is essentially a temporary monthly $30 discount on your internet bill. For those that qualify for the ACP, a one-time discount of up to $100 to purchase a computer or a tablet from participating providers is also provided. Next, please. Here at CFILC, we aim to close the digital divide one person at a time. When an individual connects with the Digital Access Project, they are fully supported by a staff member throughout the application process. We explain the affordable internet options they qualify for and which internet providers service their area. Individuals are fully walked through each step and they are not upsold during the enrollment process. Lastly, individuals who need additional support will receive an individualized referral based on their needs. An example is a referral to Human IT. Next, please. On this slide, you will find our contact information. To receive help filling out a low-cost internet application, you can fill out the online survey, email, text, or call us. You should have already received these slides through your email. If you haven't, contact us. Our emails have been dropped in the chat. Feel free to share our contact information with anyone who might be interested in learning more about our program and reach out to us. We're here to help. Thank you for learning about the Digital Access Project. I will now pass it over to Catherine with Freedom Tech.
Thank you, Victor and Inay. This slide displays the lovely Freedom Tech logo across the top half. Hi again, my name is Catherine Crowley and I'm the Ability Tools Program Manager, which means that I also have the fortune to work on the Freedom Tech Loan Team. I'm joined by my colleagues, Phil Thompson, CFILC's Administrative and Accounting Director, and Justin Caton, CFILC's Bookkeeper. And we'd like to tell you about the Freedom Tech Loan Program. Next slide, please. Sticking with the theme that I mentioned during the ability tools portion of today, our program supporting one another. Whether you need support closing that digital divide by having access to devices that can interact with the internet around you, or if you need support in acquiring other kinds of AT that you learned about and interacted with through the Ability Tools program, that's where Freedom Tech can come in. So let's get started learning about Freedom Tech. First off, if you are wondering what Freedom Tech is, it is a low interest financial loan program. Freedom Tech loans can be used to purchase a variety of assistive technology, which we defined earlier in the Ability Tools slides as any item, device, or piece of equipment used to maintain or improve the lives of people with disabilities, providing more independence in education, employment, recreation, and daily living activities. So this could include, but isn't limited to, items such as hearing aids, wheelchairs, vehicle modifications, computers, tablets, or software, and home modifications like ramps or lifts. However, it can't be utilized for construction loans. Specifically, the Freedom Tech Loan Program offers financial loans for AT that directly interacts with a person's disability. If you're wondering why the program exists, it exists to serve disabled Californians who cannot get a loan for their assistive technology for reasonable terms. People with disabilities typically have more non-standard income sources, typically have lower credit scores due to medically related debt, and typically need more assistive devices than the general population. The Freedom Tech Loan Program recognizes these facts and allows for a broader spectrum of income types, unique debt barriers, and serves the specific needs for assistive devices. Something that might also be important to you is knowing who approves applications. Once the application is ready to approve, an anonymous version of the application is then given to a loan committee. This committee takes debt types and circumstances into account when approving. They're not just a numbers-driven black and white panel like a traditional loan. And with that, I'm going to go ahead and hand it off to Phil to tell us more.
Hi. My name is Phil Thompson, Finance Director at CFILC. Again, in case somebody joined after I told you who I was earlier, I'm a white male, gray, brown hair, wearing glasses. Logo in the background is the CFILC yellow logo. Freedom Tech offers loans between the amount of $500 up to a maximum of $15,000. The loan terms range from anywhere from 6 months on up for the $500 loan up to 5 years for larger loans. The loan terms is dependent on the life of the device and the consumer's loan amount and their repayment ability and how long of a loan they are trying to stretch the payments out to. The Freedom Tech loan rate is at 6%, and there is no prepayment penalty if they pay it off early. The rate is reduced by a quarter of a percent when they choose to set up auto payment ECH payments. We also have a one-time loan origination fee of 1%, and this amount can be added to the loan so the consumer has no out-of-pocket expenses up front for getting the loan. I would like to pass it to Justin now.
Hello again. For those of you that may have joined late, my name is Justin Caton. I am the bookkeeper here at CFILC. I am a middle-aged Caucasian male with a shaved head and a graying goatee, wearing a black polo shirt in front of the yellow CFILC background with the logos for all of our programs. Who can qualify for a loan? Anyone identifying as having a disability or the authorized representative of someone they are facilitating the purchase for can assist as a co-signer, but the person with the disability needs to be on the loan. The only exception to this is if the applicant is a minor, then the parent or guardian must be on the loan, not just a representative. The California residents You must be a California resident. If you are away from California, we can direct you to your AT program in your state to see if they have a loan program. You must be over the age of 18, unless you are a minor, in which case your parent or guardian will need to be on the loan. You must have a stable income and a good payment history. Once again, it goes into the anonymous committee for review without any names attached to it. Seeking financing for qualifying devices, when we perform the intake, we will offer to attempt to facilitate getting the item financed in other ways before you try to get the loan. However, if you ultimately only want the loan, that decision is yours. Please visit our Freedom Tech loan application page to begin the process. Have a good day, and I will be passing it off to our next team, which is our DDAR team, Allie, Lisa, and Carla.
Thank you, Justin. Hi, my name is Allison Feldmeyer. I go by Allie. I am a Caucasian, a female presenting person with light skin, brown hair with blonde highlights. My pronouns are she, her. My background behind me appears as a rainbow with the CFILC logo, as well as all of the other program logos that we have here at CFILC. I am the DDAR manager. I've been with CFILC since May of 2022. I'm going to go ahead and pass it off to Lisa Austin to go ahead and introduce herself. We'll pass it off to Carla to introduce herself. Lisa, you want to take it away?
Sure. Thanks, Allie. My name is Lisa Austin, and I have been with CFILC for 7 years, and I am currently the Disability Disaster Access Resource Assistant Manager, and I am a white female with blonde brown hair, blue eyes. I'm wearing a burgundy sweater. I have an orange background with the DDAR logo, and I think with that, I'll pass it over to Carla.
Hello, everyone. It is me again. I introduced myself in the beginning, but for those of you who were not there for that, my name is Carla Leon. I am a program coordinator for the DAR program, and I've been with CFILC for about 7 months now. I will go ahead and pass it on over to Allie. She will go ahead and let you know a little about our awesome program.
Thanks, team. We'll go ahead and hit the next slide. So what is DDAR? The DDAR program stands for Disability Disaster Access and Resources. It was launched in 2020. Our primary funder is PG&E, although we have some relationships with statewide funders and are currently exploring new avenues with other power utility companies. Our program aims to provide power dependent individuals with the resources they need during planned and unplanned power outages. Forms of assistance include, but are not limited to, emergency planning, disaster go kits, backup batteries, and hotel accommodations. We might also provide transportation, food and gas accommodations, as well as hotel accommodations during in-event support services. I'm gonna turn it back over to Carla, who's gonna describe the application process. Carla, you're muted.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Like all things, this does require an application. consumers can apply here directly at the link above. The PowerPoint is also attached now in the chat. If you have not received a copy of it, we can send it at the end. Consumers can apply directly on our website, or you may download a PDF version of our Spanish application or our English application. You will fill out personal information as well as additional information. An example of our information that we collect is on the image below. which includes types of assistant technology or durable medical equipment that is being used in your household, as well as how long the listed devices are currently being used, and household demographics and electric providers. Then your application will be sent over to the corresponding Disability Disaster Resource Center, or DDARC, for your area. A representative will then contact you for intake and further questions. Please note, due to a high volume of interest, processing may take up to 3 weeks, although turnaround time is usually a lot quicker than that. I will go ahead and turn it over to Lisa Austin to speak more about in-event support.
Yes, in event support, we support the disability community through our 15 or 20 DDART centers across the state. We help plan for emergency planning for each individual, battery deliveries. We have offer hotel accommodations, vouchers for fuel, propane, for gas, for your car. We can cover transportation for you to get to and from a hotel or a community resource center if it's available. We also provide vouchers for meals. And there's an infographic on the right side of this page that shows our most recent event that we had due to the atmospheric river. And we were activated on Sunday, January 1st, and we were deactivated the 21st of the month. So that's the longest event that we've been able to have. Listed on here are the 15 DDAR centers that were active during this event. There were 40 counties impacted by this, and a lot of great work came out of it. The bottom of this infographic is some of the details on what we provided during the event. So we had 261 hotel nights that we reserved for people. We gave out 151 vouchers, gift cards for gas, propane, or personal vehicles, generators. We had 230 people get vouchers were given for food during the event. We had 217 emergency escalations and 58 gift cards for gas. Next slide. So activation status for us comes from the electric utility provider in the area that's being impacted. It's determined by the number of consumers that will be without power. Once we are activated, CFILC reaches out to the DDAR centers that are impacted, the counties that are identified, and we are to be active from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. each day of the event. Event categories may include some of the following: public safety power shutoffs, also known pretty regularly now as PSPS events. Those are planned outages. The goal during a PSPS is to prevent wildfires due to the high wind and extreme heat that can cause power lines to go down. The DDAR program is prepped in advance. We get a little bit of advance notice to prepare our DDAR centers in the various counties to be in touch with their consumers as needed. Once activated, the DDARs provide outreach to the impacted consumers and provide support for them for the duration of the outage. Other events, such as one I just explained as far as the atmospheric river, they're unplanned outages. They are determined by numbers of consumers without power in the impacted areas. Areas are typically, for us, different counties. Certain DDARs cover different counties. Once activated, we contact the impacted areas and the services, and they get service based on their needs of each individual. Services will vary depending on the weather event type. And that's it for me, I believe. Allie?
Thank you, Lisa. So another fund I do want to discuss, we are trying to reinvigorate funding for our Richard DeVelder Disaster Relief Fund. On the screen, you'll see an image of Richard DeVelder that commemorates his life here on Earth. And we dedicated a fund to him. Richard DeVelder was an advocate who worked to ensure disabilities were not ignored or neglected before, during, or after emergencies or natural disasters. CFILC developed the Richard DeVelder Disaster Relief Fund to honor Richard's commitment to the disability community in 2017. Funds have been raised to assist folks in California who are forced to evacuate without their assistive technology, or AT, or durable medical equipment, DME. Funds are also available to replace AT and DME lost after natural disasters. Right now, our coffers are pretty low with the Richard DeVelder Disaster Relief Fund. If you are aware of anybody in your community who may have interest in donations to this fund, we are hoping to reinvigorate this in 2023 to provide more comprehensive support to our disability communities. Interest in this could include agencies who might have vested interest in donations, as well as personal interest to donate. Our link to donate is cfilc.org/donate. Next slide, we have an image of our QRC code to download and donate directly to the Richard DeVelder Disaster Relief Fund. I do want to make space and let you all know our websites right now are a little finicky as we merge to our new web server. So this image may actually not take you at this time to our directly to our donation fund without prompting an error. But I do encourage you to save this QRC code to push out to your community members and your agency connections. Of course, this will be available to download in the slide deck, which you have access to. Next slide, please. So you may be wondering how you might be able to get in contact with DDAR. Perhaps you're another power utility company on the call, or you're another agency with some interest in getting involved. Or maybe you're a community member or have know a community member that may benefit from some of the services that we're providing. You can find us on disabilitydisasteraccess.org. We also have an Instagram and a Facebook. Our Instagram is at DDAR_CA. Our Facebook is Disability Disaster Access and Resources. To contact us directly at the program at CFILC, we're reached at DDAR@CFILC.org. Our phone number is 833-560-5313. Thanks so much. I'm going to pass it on to Jacob to discuss a little bit further about our social media. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much, Allison, Carla, and Lisa. Hi, my name is Jacob Monka, and I'm the Marketing and Communications Coordinator for CFILC. I have been with the organization now since October of 2022. My pronouns are he and him. For audio purposes, I am a half Latino, half white male with short, dark brown hair. I am wearing a dark blue and white gingham dress shirt today with a black necktie and dark green prescription glasses. My background is a yellow CFILC background. So for my primary responsibility in this position is to be the voice of CFILC. There are many ways our organization communicates with our members, but we are pushing further by creating our own culture with social media and how we interact with our members on these different platforms. Whether it's from reporting numbers from current weather events from DDAR or highlighting ability tools, accessible tools for the holiday, I'm the person helping each program promote their projects and amazing work. There are many voices from each program and utilize many platforms to get our message across. If you see a new post, email blast, or any updates, that's usually me on the back end doing that. This position allows me to help spread awareness and information to our ILCs. On social media. And as we all know, this comes and goes at a rapid pace. So, always be paying attention to what we're putting up on a daily basis. During the most recent atmospheric river event in California, our collaborations with our partners, ILCs, and community organizations were significant to promote online and this kept our, which kept our members informed and safe at the same time. And we can go to the next slide, please. So where to find us? At this moment, we are currently on Facebook, Instagram, and finally TikTok. We're getting those going. Here are the handles where you could find us. It is important to note, as Ali said, that Disability Disaster Access and Resources is our newest program to be added onto social media. So be sure to follow them if there's any weather preparedness tips or any type of weather-related webinars. We will be posting about that for future use. And so for Facebook, we are on Disability Organized Network. And with this slide, we have the TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook logo. So we are on, on Facebook, we have our Disability Organized Network, Ability Tools, Youth Organized, Disabled and Proud, and Disability Disaster Access and Resources page. Okay, and we can go to the next one, please. And on our Instagram page, we have @ability_tools. For our DO network, we have @DO.org. For CFILC, we have @CFILC_1982. For DDAR, we have @DDAR_CA. And for Yo Disability and Proud, we have @YoDisabledAndProud, one word. Go forward, please. And for our newest pages for TikTok, we have @AbilityToolsCA for Ability Tools, @CFILC_1982 for California Foundation for Independent Living Centers. And for Yo Disabled and Proud, we have @YoDisabledAndProud. And we can continue forward, please. So to continue on with our journey with social media and with our newest platform for TikTok, you know, for 2023, we want to expand the story of our organization and we want to use this with TikTok because your history is our history. We want to highlight our community members' everyday lives with their daily routines and their knowledge in all of our programs, such as with Yo, To Do, and To Ability Tools. We want to see highlights. You know, the highlight with working with CFILC and TikTok is to give an incentive of a stipend payment to help us create content for our programs. It can be from highlighting new accessible technology, tips to putting together an emergency prepared backpack, or explaining resources for your from your particular ILC. This is how we want to expand our voice for the disabled community and for CFILC. We want to work with you and collaborate. With certain guidelines and appropriate themes, if you have an idea and want to promote with us, please get in talk and please get in contact with us, and we would be more than happy to talk with you about that. Our other campaigns we want to start with our narratives is with our DO Network Access success stories. You know, the stories of our community members and their success in advocating for what they believe in are the foundations from what we build. From what we built from our CFILC organization. Hearing stories from our disability organizing members inspires future generations. If you have an experience you want to share, we want to hear them. This would be promoted on social media and newsletters. It's also important to note that we also have a YouTube channel, which we are live streaming at this moment, is that all of our programs that we DO for webinars are streamed through YouTube. And they are later archived so to go back for future references. So, and other past conversations we've had with activists, emergency weather coalitions, and video projects from Yo. One of our exciting field trips we have coming up in March is with Abilities Expo in 2023, in March. We will be heading to Los Angeles to the Abilities Expo, and we're gonna be participating by covering new tools and vendors with our community members. And we will be promoting this through Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok. Moving on, we are gonna be resurrecting two newsletters this year, the Capital Connection and the Artichoke. Capital Connection newsletter will be contributed by DO Network team members in regards to policy, public policy, and legislative actions. and the other for the Artichoke will be a collective newsletter regarding all of CFILC's programs and highlights and new webinars coming up. The next campaign that we will be working with for CFILC will be highlighting every CFILC in California. And what this means is we want to feature distinct characteristics from California's independent living centers and who utilize them, you know, get to the core of our mission. This will be our opportunity to highlight the services we provide and understand the purpose of our movement and where it's headed. This can include members developing new skills with loan technology and enhancing their lifestyles. So once again, all suggestions are welcome for ideas for TikTok. My information is at the bottom of the screen on the left corner. I'm sorry, bottom right corner. I'm at jacob@cfilc.org. And my phone number is 916-281-5764. And it is important to mention that we will be having a webinar with a collaboration of Yo and Ability Tools on Tuesday about iOS updates, which are accessible. Now we will move on to the executive intention section. Thank you.
Hi, and we're actually going to cut it a little bit short because we're running out of time and we want to be sure to be able to answer all of your guys' questions. So thank you. We're going to go ahead and skip the executive intentions for the time being. Thank you all for your interest and attention today. If you have any questions for our team, please drop them into the Q&A, into the chat, or raise your hand to ask audibly, whichever option is most accessible to you. While you do that, I'm going to go ahead and pass it to Jacob to give out some prizes, to give some people some time to go ahead and put those questions in the chat. And people who have previously asked questions, I have you down. Don't worry about it.
Okay. Thank you so much, Catherine. Oh, let me get on camera. All right. So as you said from our email, we are going to have a raffle. 3 runner-ups will have a chance to pick an item from our Yo Disabled and Proud store. And our grand prize winner will be winning a $150 American Express Visa, American Express gift card. So let me pull up. I just received the winners right now. Can you just bear with me for just a moment? So, all right. So for our 3 Yo winners, we have Clay Kempf, Joe Escalante, and Kevin Hansen. Congratulations, you have won a single prize from our Yo Disabled and Proud store. And for our grand prize, I don't have a drum behind me, but I would for a buildup. But we are gonna announce that for our American Express gift card is Brian Lee. Congratulations. And we will be in contact with you to see how we could get those prizes to you. Thank you again.
Thanks so much, Jacob. I heard some familiar names in there. We definitely have our community members with us today. So let's go ahead and get started. We only have about 5 minutes. So if we don't get to your questions, I'm sorry. We have a lot of people to get through. We'll put emails and contact information in the chat, and you can always feel free to reach out to us as needed. So let's go ahead and get started with the first one I've gotten in. From Zara Khan, for the folks doing policy work, do you have any work on communication access? Example, it's nearly impossible to get medical offices to do captioned telehealth appointments or even communicate via portal or email for routine admin items. Is any advocacy work happening in this sort of area? And Dan, take it away. We don't have much time though, so.
Thank you, Zara Khan. This is Dan Okenfuss, Public Policy Manager, once again. Yes, we are always looking for new issues to address on our public policy team. And access to telehealth is very important for us, and be happy to discuss further with you independently, and we can learn more about the issue. Please email me, dan@cfilc.org.
All right. I also found a question in the chat from Faber Wilson. Does the youth course also talk about things in society in which the youth are staying in? Faber, if you can give me a little bit of clarification, I'm sure Jessica would be really happy to answer that question for you. And while Favor is clarifying their question, I have another question coming in for Dar. Can you go into more detail about the gift cards? There were a couple people in the chat asking about this.
Yeah, I'll go ahead and answer a little bit closer. So the gift cards are offered for consumers that are eligible for the program. For instance, with the meal vouchers, gift cards, those will be for people who have lost power and they're getting support at the hotel. These, unfortunately, we do not have the capacity to provide them in an e-gift card fashion. So what we do is we mail them directly to the consumer. If the consumer is due to be at the hotel for more than a couple of days, we may do a delivery in person, corresponding with the DARC that the DDARC, sorry, that can coordinate that outreach. If not, we may send the gift card to the hotel. And we do things as an as needed basis. However, if you're in a hotel, you do get a meal voucher every single day. Are there any other questions on the gift card process? Perfect, thank you.
All right, I have a hand up. If we can go ahead and unmute our attendee, 1-818-415-6923. Great, you can go ahead and unmute yourself now and you can speak.
Thank you. Hi, folks. My name is Fernando Vaughn. I'm a member of Cal Life Communities, actively living independent and free. And also I work for the State of California Employment Development Department. So great presentations. I would like to ask a question. One thing was not included in the presentation is the weather factor. My question is for CFILC during these rainy seasons throughout the whole state of California, what are you folks doing in terms of those kind of natural disasters to help our people? That's one. And question actually for Yo, Disabled and Proud. Are you ever thinking about doing a presentation on racism, discrimination, and whatnot in honor of Ed Roberts, and especially after all that's going on with the gun violence, the hatred against Asians and other minority groups? And that's my question right there. Those are my questions right there. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And we have very little time. We can probably hold for like one more minute, but if we can get Allie to answer the first question and Jessica, hop on in.
Hi, it's Allie Feldmeyer again. So to answer the question about weather-related services, in weather-related services, it becomes a little complex. We are limited in some of the resources that we can provide. Based off of whether or not we're activated by the power utility company and whether or not the power utility company that's funding us provides that level of resources to that specific county. You know, for instance, PG&E may not provide services to San Diego because they're not in the same service area. So for what we do to kind of prep consumers during these rainy seasons is, of course, providing them with emergency planning, as well as disaster go kits if their catchment decides to use that as an outreach tool. And we provide kind of resources to help facilitate that. And then we will, of course, repost and reblog anything Cal OES shares with us in terms of shelters, other sorts of resources, et cetera, et cetera. But if you're at all interested in donating or providing funds to CFILC, we'd love to make our services more comprehensive in the future.
And I'll go very quick. The answer is yes. I specifically focus on trying to find the intersectionalities of a lot of the different social issues that are currently affecting like us as a holistic level. So my whole process is that I'm trying to make sure that we're adding different social issues within the work that we do, because they're also intersectional with one another. So definitely there will be trainings. That was something that we wanted to start last year, but we're going to try to start having trainings on a monthly level. So yes, I am very passionate about what you mentioned. So it's definitely within my plate of something that we're going to be touching on very soon.
Perfect. Thank you so much, everybody, for all of your wisdom, input, and inspirations. I am truly amazed at all of our collaboration throughout the last year, and I'm extremely excited to continue to work on to 2023 with you all and hopefully get some new connections from this webinar. At the end of this meeting, you will all receive a link to a SurveyMonkey. Please take the following minutes after this meeting to fill it out and give your honest feedback, and we will happily accept any requests for future collaborations. Again, apologies for a short Q&A. Feel free to email me at Karla, K-A-R-L-A, at CFILC, and I will go ahead and forward over your questions. Enjoy the rest of your Friday and have a restful weekend, everybody. Goodbye.